In the last lecture of non-destructive testing, we had studied the laboratory methods or the resonant frequency method. In today's lecture, we will be learning the pulse velocity or the field methods. So, as we know that in pulse velocity, we have these two: mechanical sonic pulse velocity and the second one, ultrasonic pulse velocity. The important one is this one, the ultrasonic pulse velocity. So, pulse velocity method, this includes determination of the velocity of longitudinal compression waves. So when these waves are produced, they are of different nature. First are compression waves, second are shear waves, but here what we are interested in are the compressional waves. The determination consists of measurement of the time taken by a pulse to travel a measured distance. So this is a known fact that the sound travels fastest in solid medium, then it is in the liquid, and then it is in the gaseous, right? So if a solid is perfectly homogeneous and it is made, it does not have any flaws, then the velocity of the sound should be the fastest through that particular medium. But if the solid is not homogeneous, or it has some flaws into it, it has some cracks into it, then what will happen is the velocity of sound will be lower than what is expected. So this is the basic or the fundamental principle in dynamic or vibration methods, that you have to measure that sound, and then you can check based on your experience and based on your knowledge what should be the state of that particular concrete. So the apparatus includes transducers between which the velocity of the pulse has to be determined, and these are placed in contact with the concrete. A pulse generator with a frequency between 15 and 50 kilohertz, an amplifier to amplify those pulses, a time measuring circuit, and a digital display of the time taken by the pulse of longitudinal wave to travel between the transducers. The test method is prescribed by ASTM C59709 and by BSEN 125044 2004. The wave velocity V in a homogeneous, isotropic and elastic medium is related to the dynamic modulus of elasticity ED, and it is given by this expression: V square is ED into 1 minus mu upon rho plus 1 plus mu into 1 minus 2 mu, where mu is the Poisson's ratio, ED is the dynamic modulus of elasticity, and V is the velocity of wave in that in the medium in which we are considering to find the dynamic modulus of elasticity. Yet again, as we know that concrete is not perfectly homogeneous, hence it does not fit this equation of finding the dynamic modulus of elasticity, but approximately it can be found out, and therefore these methods also give you an approximate estimation of the strength of the concrete. Now pulse velocity, here it is given the pulse velocity range and the general conditions of the concrete. So you can see that for the maximum pulse velocity here, it is excellent condition, which means that your concrete is almost free of flaws, and the sound travels very fast through the body of the concrete. Then you can see that as and how the pulse velocity goes on reducing, the general condition of the concrete is going on reducing. So it is from good to questionable to poor to very poor. This is again given by IS code, the second table, and in this also the velocity of the pulse wave is given, but it is in kilometers per second. So it is almost the same thing what is written here. This was in meters per second, this is in kilometers per second. And what IS code suggests is that above 4.5 it is excellent, then good, medium and doubtful. Okay. So the techniques of measuring pulse velocity through concrete are by three methods. First is direct transmission, second indirect transmission, and third surface transmission. So let us see what these three methods are. This method is called as direct transmission. So in this, what we have is, this is the body of the concrete, this is one transducer, and this is the second transducer, this is a transmitter, this is a receiver. So both are essentially transducers, but one functions as a transmitter. It transmits the pulse velocity. Second will function as a receiver. It will receive that signal. And so you can see that this is the direct connection. So this is called as direct transmission. Second, indirect transmission. So this way is called as indirect transmission. So let us say that we have a body of concrete and one transducer transmitter is attached here, second receiver is attached this way. So in the first case, can you tell where it can be used? First case can be mostly used for, let's say, slabs or even beams, right? The structures whose top and bottom can be accessed, those structures can be done by this direct transmission, right? Or even we can say even columns, when if this is a column, let us say, then one we can attach on this side and the other one we can attach on the back side, so that can also be termed into a direct transmission. This indirect transmission, again, this can be applied for beams, right? If this is a slab and this is a beam here, like this. So of course we can use direct transmission also here, but we can also use indirect transmissions like this. Or this indirect transmission can be used for those members whose dimensions are very, very large. For example, this dimension is very large, let's say it's of 10 meters. This is also a 10 meter large dimension. Mostly you can assume like a dam or something. In dams, the concreting that is done is mass concreting. So in such case, we can use this indirect transmission. That is, we can put a transmitter here, we can put a receiver this side, and we can do that indirect transmission. Okay, the third one is called a surface transmission. So in this we have a concrete surface whose lateral dimension, lateral sides or the bottom side is not, we cannot access it. So we have to place the transmitter and the receiver on the same surface. So this is called a surface transmission. This can be used for let us say foundations, where you do not want to dig and reach the bottom of the foundation. So you can either just place it on the surface of the foundation and you can find the flaws which are there in the concrete. Now, the factors affecting the pulse velocity test. First is the smoothness of contact surface under test. So what happens is that this pulse velocity, it requires the surface to be smooth enough so that the pulse can be transmitted very easily. If there are undulations on the surface, then the pulse that you are transmitting, that is, it is basically a sound, right? So that sound can get distorted from the reflection from these surfaces, and therefore we need the top surface to be very smooth. And in general cases, on the structures which are there on site, they are generally smoothened out at the end, so it does not pose any problem. But in cases if it is not smoothened enough, then we have to use this. This is called as carborundum, and it is used for smoothening of surfaces. So this can be used, and then we can go ahead with the pulse velocity test. So yeah, that's what is written here. Along with this, we for additional accuracy, what we do is that we pour a jelly type of thing on the surface, and in that the transducers are dipped, so that the sound, the pulse that is generated, it goes effectively into the surface. So can you see this wet thing, something here? That is that thin oil or thin film of oil or jelly or kaolin glycerol, something like that. So because of that, the any undulation which is there in the surface, it gets covered up. Let's say that this is a surface which is very undulated. When you put this kaolin or jelly and everything, then that covers up these undulations. So now our surface becomes extremely smooth enough for the effective transmission of the pulses. So let us assume that there is a column, a huge column, and we want to do this ultrasonic pulse velocity. And in this column, there is some flaw near one of the edges. Okay, and what you do is that you say that you want to do the indirect transmission for this. You want to use that method, indirect transmission. So you place your transmitter here, you place your receiver here, and then you find the pulse velocity. What you will be getting is a very weak pulse velocity because of the flaw present here. But is it showing the state of your entire concrete material? No, it is only showing the state of this local part where it is flawed, right? So in such case, when your path length of the velocity is very less, in that case it can give you some inaccurate results. So for perfect homogeneity, and also this flaw can arise because the concrete is not a perfectly homogeneous material. So in order to account that, in order to account the perfect homogeneity of concrete, what you have to do is you have to keep, let's say, your receiver here and your transducer here. If you are going for indirect transmission, if you are going for direct transmission, then receiver here and transmitter on the other side, like this, so that the path of the velocity is increased and it can encompass more concrete along its way. So more the concrete it encompasses, better results you can expect, and so that you can say that the overall quality of the column is good or bad accordingly from that. So yeah, this is what the influence of path length on pulse velocity. But in laboratory, where you have to conduct this pulse velocity test on small specimens, in that case generally it affects the pulse velocity readings, because you will not get a large path length for your pulse velocity. Third is temperature of concrete. So a temperature variation between 5 degrees and 30 degrees Celsius does not significantly affect the pulse velocity measurement, but temperatures between 30 and 60 degrees, which is a lot, there can be a 5% reduction in pulse velocity. This is probably due to the initiation of micro cracking in concrete. So at large temperatures, there are micro cracks which are formed inside the concrete, and once these micro cracks can be considered as flaws inside the concrete, and once the flaws are induced in the concrete, definitely the pulse velocity is going to decrease. At below freezing temperatures, the free water freezes within the concrete, thus resulting in an increase in pulse velocity. At 4 degrees Celsius, an increase of up to 7.5% in the pulse velocity through water saturated concrete has been reported. So when the water freezes, it also becomes solid. So in that case, the pulse velocity can have higher values, and it can report an inaccurate state of that particular concrete. So here in this graph, it is given according to the temperature, and for air dried concrete and water saturated concrete, what should be the correction percentage. So for plus 60 degrees, the correction in the ultrasonic pulse velocity should be plus 5%. So you have to increase your pulse velocity readings by 5% for air dried concrete, and for water saturated concrete you have to increase it by 4%, so that you are near the correct readings. You get correct readings after the correction is applied. For plus 50 degrees temperature, it is plus 3.5%. So as the temperature goes on decreasing, the correction goes on decreasing, and at 20 degrees Celsius, it is the ideal temperature at which this test has to be carried. As we go down, the correction is in negative. It means that whatever pulse velocity you are getting, you have to decrease that by 0.5% in air dried concrete and by 1% in water saturated concrete. And if it is minus 4 degrees and below, it is minus 1.5% and minus 7.5%, right? And next one is moisture condition of concrete. So what moisture condition suggests is that in the concrete we have pores, and those pores can be either filled by water or they won't be filled by water. If they are filled by water, that would be called as a saturated concrete, and if they are not filled by water, it would be called as a dry concrete. So if my pulse velocity has to travel through a saturated and a dry concrete, in dry concrete it will go through solid particles of concrete, and then it will traverse through the dry air voids. So in air voids, what will happen? The velocity of the pulse will decrease, right? So in saturated and dry concrete, we have pores that are filled with water, and here we have void pores, or I would void pores would be better, which means that it is filled with nothing. So in void pores, the velocity will decrease because it has to now traverse through air, and in pores filled with water, the velocity will be higher than this velocity. So generally in saturated concrete, what you would see is that you will see a higher pulse velocity readings as compared to the dry concrete. And I hope you understood why is that happening. Next is presence of reinforcing steel. Now when we talk about RCC, definitely it is going to have steel present into it. And if we are taking pulse velocity readings of an RCC, then the pulse velocity or the pulse is also going to pass through the steel. If it has to pass through the body of the concrete, definitely it will encounter steel somewhere. And what is seen is that steel is definitely more denser than concrete. It has densely packed molecules, and that is the reason the velocity of pulse is almost 1.5 times to 2 times of that of concrete. So if the pulse is passing through steel, it is going to record higher velocities, and it might give you a wrong result at the end. So in that case also, again, the orientation of the steel and the orientation of your pulse velocity path, that is also important. For example, if my reinforcing bars are like this, okay, in this direction, and if the pulse velocity path is like this, let's say, okay, I will just draw it. Let's say this is a concrete body, and I have placed my transmitter, I have placed it here. I am doing the direct transmission, and receiver I have placed here. Okay, so transmitter and receiver here. Now the pathway of my pulse velocity is like this, correct? So this pathway will have lesser contact with the steel overall, correct? So in this case, when the axis of the reinforcement is perpendicular to the axis of the path of your pulse velocity, path of your pulse basically, then the correction required is of lesser magnitude, and almost like 1% to 2%. But if the axis of the reinforcement is parallel to the axis of your pulse, that is, if my transmitter is here and if my receiver is also here like this, then your pulse velocity has to pass through, it can pass through concrete from some points, it will pass through steel from some points. So in this case, what will happen is it will give you very erroneous results. There would be a error of high amount, and to correct that error also, the correction that is applied to such a case, that will also be of approximate nature. So in such case, it is very difficult to find the actual velocity of pulse through that body of concrete. And let us say that you are doing a test in which there are two-way steel. Two-way steel means the steel is like this in one direction and then steel is like this also in the other direction. So in such case, if even if you place the transducer and transmitter from like this or from top also, it is definitely going to encounter a lot of steel in its pathway and the correction is going to be of higher magnitude and of approximate nature as well. So this is what I have explained you, right? You can take notes from this if you want. Next is application of pulse velocity method. So till now we studied the factors affecting the pulse velocity. Now we will be studying the application of that, and the first application is determination of dynamic modulus of elasticity. Now what you have to see in this is that for dynamic modulus of elasticity we can also use those resonant frequency methods and we can also use this pulse velocity method, but it is seen that there is a quite difference between the results obtained from both of them, and this is because the concrete is highly heterogeneous material and it also has a lot of other factors involved, like Poisson's ratio is there, and if because concrete is not perfectly isotropic, for isotropic we have only modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio, these two variables are there, but when it goes beyond that, when we go into orthotropic or those things, then the number of constants increase which will give you the correct estimation. So in that case, some researchers, what they do is they don't find the modulus of elasticity in this pulse velocity method. They directly use that pulse velocity as an indicator of the strength. So, and it has a very direct relation, because the pulse velocity, more the pulse velocity, better is the state of the concrete for which we are testing. Lesser the pulse velocity, bad is the state of the concrete for which we are testing. But if in case you want to compute the modulus of elasticity, then this is that formula, V square is ED into 1 minus mu of 15 into 1 plus mu into 1 minus 2 mu. And this is also considering that concrete is isotropic, but if it becomes orthotropic, then you have 9 elastic constants. And then it becomes much, much more difficult. Right? So this was about determination of dynamic modulus of elasticity. Next we have estimation of strength of concrete, and this is what the researchers use. Instead of going to find the dynamic modulus of elasticity, they have made this chart in which you have pulse velocity on one axis and compressive strength on the other axis. So directly you can refer this graph and you can find the compressive strength, and this is also dependent on cement aggregate ratios. So this is for 1:9 cement aggregate ratio, this is for 1:7.5, 1:6, 1:4.5, and 1:3. So for different cement to aggregate ratios we have different graphs. Based on that you can find the approximate compressive strength of the material that we are testing. Next is determination of setting characteristics of concrete. So determination of the rate of setting of concrete by means of sonoscope has been widely used. So how can you determine the setting characteristics of concrete? We know that concrete changes its consistency as it hardens or as it sets. So it goes from the flowable consistency to a very hard consistency, right from the point when it is poured into the formwork till the point it becomes hardened, right? So if you are measuring the pulse velocity right from the point it was poured into that formwork and it had a flowable consistency, so you will have some lesser velocity of pulse in that case, because it is not a solid till that point. The moment it goes on hardening, the pulse velocity is going to increase correspondingly, and at the end stage when it hardens completely, you will be having a greater reading or a higher reading of pulse velocity. So if you take a lot of readings from the point it was poured or from the point it was in flowable state to the point it becomes a hard concrete, you will have a lot of readings of pulse velocity with you, and from that you can determine that at what stage it changed its consistency and what state it became from a liquid or from a flowable state to a semi-solid state and from a semi-solid state to a solid state. So that can be studied using this method as well. So this was it for today's lecture. In the next lecture we'll be learning some more about non-destructive testing. Till then, take care. Thank you.